Ladies and gentlemen, on this occasion, you're invited to travel back in time to the city of Jerusalem. The year is AD 31. A court session is just beginning, in which an inquisition will be held in an attempt to determine the truth of the character of one called Jesus of Nazareth, who claims to be the Son of God. You are summoned to be the jury who will decide as to whether these claims are true or false, as presented by the witnesses. Please follow the directions of the bailiff, and at the end of the court session, you will be asked to deliver your verdict.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, today's court is now in session. The first case today is that of Jesus Christ of the town of Nazareth. The Honorable Bartholomew Justice will preside. Please rise. You may be seated.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you're called here today to answer a very important question, whether the man Jesus Christ of Nazareth is indeed who he claims to be, and that is the promised Messiah, the Holy One extolled by the prophets of old. As you may have heard, his birth is said to have been miraculous. But to others, they say it's a cover story for an illegitimate beginning. It is rumored that he has performed many miracles and has even raised from the dead. This has caused a lot of disturbance and disagreement for his purpose here. His claim to kingship has been said to be a threat to our national interest. These are unusual and serious charges. We have sought those who were witnesses to his life and have summoned them here in order to determine the truthfulness of this claim. You, the jury, are called upon to take careful note of the comments of each of these key witnesses. You are to attempt to determine in your own minds as to whether this man, Jesus, is who he claims to be. You will be called upon at the end by standing vote to give your verdict after the testimonies have been completed. Bailiff, you may call the first witness.
Your Honor, the first witness is John, a cousin of the person in question. Please state your name for the jury.
My name is John, son of Zechariah, called the Baptizer.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
To begin, I have to go back to my own life. I was a miracle child. My father, Zechariah, the priest, and my mother, Elizabeth, were rather old and beyond childbearing years. And at my father's division and time appointed, he was in the temple. And there in the temple, at the right of the altar of incense, appeared an angel who said to him, Zechariah, do not be afraid, for the Lord has heard your prayers and will answer them. And you will have a son, and you will call him John. For he will be one who will come to bring the children of Israel back to God. And so it was that I was born. And at the appointed time, I was sent into the Jordan to baptize a baptism of repentance. And the Jews sent priests and Levites to me, and they asked me, who are you? Are you the Christ? I said, no. Are you the prophet? No. Are you Elijah? No. Then what do you say about yourself? And I told them that I am one coming from the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord. And so they asked me, if you're not these three, then why do you baptize? And I said, I baptize in water. But one is standing among you that I'm not even worthy to unlatch his sandal. The very next day, I saw him, Jesus of Nazareth, coming, and I shouted, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. I said this because when Jesus had come to me to be baptized, I suggested perhaps that I should be baptized of him, but he said, no, make it so to fulfill all righteousness. And as he came up out of the water, I saw the Holy Spirit descend and remain upon him, and I heard the voice from heaven. And he who sent me into the wilderness to baptize told me that upon whom you see the Spirit fall and remain, this is the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit. And so I'm here today to tell you, to testify, that Jesus of Nazareth is the Son of God.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Nicodemus. Please state your name for the jury.
I am Nicodemus, an honored member of the Sanhedrin, our National Jewish Council.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
Well, along with many other people, I had heard about Jesus, and I was stirred by some of the teachings that he had made, and I realized that today his character is being brought into question here. Now, I had heard some of the wonderful truths that he had taught, and I very wanted to know more about them, but I realized that not everyone felt as I did. I was in the temple the day that Jesus threw out the money changers. And some of the leaders of the temple and the priests were not very happy about that. They wondered, what is this lowly man doing taking over jurisdiction of what's ours? Well, being a member of the Sanhedrin, I cautioned some of the members who wanted to censure Jesus. And I remembered back in the history of our nation that we had treated very severely with some of the people that had been sent to us to send us words of correction. And so I told them, I said, you might want to wait about censuring Jesus because some of the calamities that happened to our nation, we might not want to happen anymore here. So they held off for a while. And I wanted to know a little more about Jesus. I'd heard of some of the wonderful truths that he had been teaching, of some of the healings that he had been performing. But I didn't want to embarrass myself by some of the leaders of the temple and some of the other priests. So I thought, well, maybe I could arrange meeting Jesus at nighttime rather than being in the daytime or where it might embarrass me. So I had heard that Jesus went to the Mount of Olives at nighttime, sometimes after the city was hushed in sleep, and he prayed and meditated out there. So I arranged to meet him one evening. Well, as I went out there, I thought, here I am, a leader. I want to have an air of confidence. I want Jesus to think that I'm worthy. But you know, when I got out there and got into the presence of Jesus, I wanted to feel real confident, but I didn't. I had a feeling of being very timid. And I think Jesus recognized that in me, that even though I wanted to go out there and extol the fact that I was a leader and that I was a great person here, Jesus looked at me, and even though I wanted to show confidence, I had a feeling of kind of unbelief. And Jesus looked at me and said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And I thought, whoa, wait a minute. I'm a strict Pharisee. I give money to the temple. I have a benevolent acts that I follow. I've done a lot for our Jewish people. And this sounds like that he's indicating that there's a kingdom of God that I'm not really ready for, or that I'm not capable of being a part of, that I'm not pure enough for that. And so it irritated me a little bit. And I thought, he seems like he's honing in right on me and pointing me out to this. So I thought to myself, and I asked Jesus, how can a man be born again if he's old? And even though I knew some of the aspects and the philosophy of being rebirthed, Jesus looked at me very quietly and sincerely, and he raised his hand and he said, Nicodemus, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And then Jesus went on to explain to me that it's not what we do, it's not all the rituals and the keeping of the law and the traditions is what makes us entitled to the kingdom of God. In the presence of Jesus, I felt my heart was unclean and that my life was unholy at this time. Well, the revelation was that we cannot depend upon ourselves and what we do for ourselves, that we really need to depend wholly on God and His merits, because our merits mean nothing. Even though we have rituals and we have traditions that we take of, we must look to God and not to ourselves for salvation. Well, for 3 years, I kind of kept these things in my heart. It was the uneasiness of the people. Not everyone felt the same way about Jesus. So I kept these in my heart, and I was reminded when Jesus was lifted up on the cross, of the time he reminded me back when I was talking to him that night, that back in the day in the wilderness, when Moses told the people there, and he held up this brazen or brass snake and said, you must look to this so that the snake bites won't affect you. Well, when Jesus was lifted up on the cross, it reminded me of the wilderness and when the snake had been lifted up and it saved the people there. Jesus was made sin for us so that we could live. Well, my mind was illuminated and I saw in Jesus the world's Redeemer. After Jesus' crucifixion, most of the Jews thought that the church would just die out. But I'll have to say that I, from a financial point and from other points, I supported that early infant church. And even though from a financial point it made me poor, in doing so, I faithfully supported from the early church from that time on. And as far as Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Your Honor, that's my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Peter. Please state your name for the jury.
I'm Peter, follower of Jesus.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
As I said, my name is Peter. I'm a fisherman by trade. I was one of the first and closest of Jesus' disciples. Well, I'll have to admit, I wasn't necessarily the most easy guy to get along with, especially when Jesus and I first met. I was pretty boisterous, a bit crude and pretty wild, but Jesus, well, he was different. You know, I never heard him swear or get angry at anyone. Oh, we did have some upset times with those priests sometimes, but that was because of their hypocrisy. I guess you'd just say I had a lot to learn. Heck, Jesus promised to make us fishermen of men. Talking about fishing, I remember one time where we'd been fishing all night long and had nary a fish to show for all of our labors. Jesus showed up and he said, cast your net on the other side. Seemed pretty hopeless to me. We'd been fishing there all night. I was pretty skeptical, but we threw our nets in anyway. In a matter of moments, those nets were so full that we could barely pull them in for failure that they might break. I couldn't believe it. I was so impressed then with the power that Jesus had that I fell down on my knees in praise and awe. I knew for sure this was no ordinary man. One time, when my mother-in-law was really sick, Jesus came over and healed her on the spot. We were always so very thankful for that. He was amazing. He was willing to help anyone, everyone, even to raising the dead on occasion. All these things made me pretty excited and eager to follow him. It was pretty amazing to see all the things he could do, including calming the Sea of Galilee one night when it was just storming, and the rest of us were on the bottom of the boat, scared and panicked. Jesus even allowed me to walk on the water one time to come out to him. That was really cool too, until I got just a little bit cocky and started to sink. But Jesus reached down and pulled me right back up. I'll never forget the time that James and John and I went up on the mountain with Jesus, and he was there with Moses and Elijah, and they were wrapped together in a bright cloud and they were talking. That was really scary, mostly because of the brightness. We heard a voice out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved son, hear him." We were told not to share that with anyone for a while, but it sure made an impression on me. I had just heard God the Father speak. Right before Jesus was condemned to die, we had gone to an upper room to celebrate the Passover. Usually a servant would be there to wash our feet, but this time there was no one there. We disciples looked around at each other, and we were kind of uncomfortable with the whole thing, waiting to see who was going to do what. It got pretty awkward and pretty quiet. Then, believe it or not, we saw Jesus stoop down, gird himself up for the job, insisting that he must wash our feet. I was blown away by that. Here he was, our master, our leader, our savior, stopping down to wash my dirty feet. No way. It wasn't going to happen. He wasn't going to wash my feet. How humiliating was that? I was really upset. I was determined, until Jesus slowed me down by saying, "If I wash thee not, then thou hast no part with me." There was no way. There was no way that I wanted not to be involved with Jesus. So I told him not just to wash my feet, wash my hands, wash my head. That was quite an experience. Made me realize then just how humble of a man that Jesus was. I remember vividly the night when Jesus was arrested. A mob had descended down into the garden where Jesus had been praying. They came with sticks and swords to get him. He was just some normal criminal. I was really indignant about it and decided I was going to defend Jesus. I took a whack at one of the servants of the high priest. As it happened, I just lopped off his ear. My aim wasn't that good. He was lucky. That's all that came off. I was really angry. Jesus immediately reprimanded me, put the guy's ear back on, and healed him on the spot. The thing that probably bothers me the most, Your Honor, is the way I acted the night of Jesus' trial. When I saw the mob taking Jesus away, I followed them and hung around where some of the men had a fire going so that I could find out just what they were going to do with them. I had previously promised Jesus that I would never, ever deny him. But he said, "Yeah, you will." I found that hard to believe, but I tried not to think about it again. But then the servant girl came around and noticed my accent, and she commented that I must be one of Jesus' disciples. With Jesus on trial and the priests and the mob so determined to condemn him, I wasn't feeling so brave anymore. I denied that I knew him. Then this girl just kept on until finally I cursed and swore I never, ever knew Jesus. By that time, I caught a glimpse of Jesus looking back at me. The look of sadness in his eyes just crushed me. I knew what I had done. And at that moment, something inside of me just died. I was so upset at what I had done that I rushed back to the garden and cried like a baby. How could I have done that to my master? How could he ever forgive me? I realized that Jesus knew me then better than I knew myself. After that experience, I was a changed man, Your Honor. I finally saw myself for what I was and knew that only Jesus could change me. And that is my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down.
Shalom.
Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Mary. Please state your name for the jury.
I am Mary of Nazareth, mother of Jesus, wife of Joseph.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
I have been called in question as to whether I believe that my son, Jesus, is the Son of God, and I can only tell you what I have experienced. I was but a maiden betrothed to him, my husband Joseph, when a holy being came unto me to tell me that God's Holy Spirit would come upon me and I would conceive in my body the Holy One, the promised Messiah that my people have long been waiting for. At first I was startled and afraid, but then when I realized what was to happen, I could not help but praise the Lord for such an honor. This holy child grew up obedient in our home, and many times you could hear him singing praises as he worked with his father Joseph in the carpenter's shop. When he was only 12 years old, we found Jesus in the holy temple, talking with the priests and answering their questions. As he grew to manhood, he always avoided those things that were morally questionable. And he was not like other children in that he never once yielded to sin, but was a model of virtue and always showing sympathy for the downtrodden. I saw him perform a miracle at a wedding. He turned the water into wine when the wedding feast supply had ran short. Mostly, Jesus seemed to be on a serious mission at all times, quick to heal the brokenhearted, to relieve pain and suffering, and healing all people wherever he went. The priests and leaders seemed to be very jealous of Jesus, of his influence upon the people, and they went out of their way to try to trick him into disobeying God's holy law and the Jewish practices. But Jesus was patient with them and kind, hoping that he would win their hearts. But he also had to point out to them their hypocrisy in that they wanted all of us to obey Moses' laws and all the extra rules and restrictions that the priests put upon all the people, but they themselves were reluctant to follow. Despite the fact that Jesus went about teaching the people the gospel of God, feeding them when they were hungry, and healing them, the priests and leaders were so threatened by Jesus that they called for his death. They were afraid of Jesus because no man ever spoke as he did. And they knew that they were losing their influence upon the people, upon the people's hearts. When the priests finally succeeded in having Jesus condemned to death by crucifixion, I was beyond grief. And then I remembered that just and devout man, Simeon, who desired to see the promised Messiah and came to the temple at the very time that we brought Jesus as a baby to be dedicated to God. The Holy Spirit had revealed to Simeon that he would not see death until he saw the promised one. Simeon's words to me, though, regarding Jesus came back very sharply, for he had said, "Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and to be a sign which shall be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." Simeon's words could not have been truer. It was anguishing to see this miracle son of mine, so wretchedly abused and tormented I could hardly stand to look upon the scene, knowing that I was helpless, that there was nothing that I could do. As Jesus was hanging on the cross, you would have expected, with all his stress and anguishing pain to his body, his heart, and his soul, that he would not have a thought or concern for others. But as his disciple John stood there beside me, he said, "Woman, behold thy son." And he said to John, "Behold thy mother." His incredible goodness and concern for others to the very end of his life on this earth overwhelmed my heart. Your Honor, I do have another testimony in song, if you will allow.
That is a most unusual request, but considering the circumstances, this court grants permission for you to continue your testimony in song.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Caiaphas. Please state your name for the jury.
I am Caiaphas, the acting high priest.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
Your Honor, I was told this Jesus, whom we Sadducees despise, was being brought to me one night. Actually, it was early one morning, but we had to have the trial at night. The Sanhedrin had been called to come and join us, but they were uneasy about getting out of bed at that hour, plus we were having the trial against our own laws. But we took the opportunity to try to nail this Jesus, if we could, this troublemaker. Most of the people seemed to hang on his every word, and I admit I was getting really upset because they were so impressed with him. No one seemed to be paying attention to me anymore, and I had had enough. We had lined up some witnesses to speak against him, and we hoped we could make short work of this trial. About that time, I saw torches and lanterns weaving their way up the stairs to my palace, and I thought I could see Jesus being dragged along with a band of armed men. When the Roman soldiers were stationed at the foot of my throne and Jesus had arrived, I was anxious to get started. I knew that we were on shaky ground having the trial at night, since that was forbidden, but we knew that we couldn't have it in the day because of Jesus' followers. They would protest. The excitement was really intense as we began, but I just noticed that Jesus was standing there, noble and dignified in his bearing. For a moment, I felt somehow that this man might be akin to God. But away with such thought. I had a job to do. I thought it would be interesting to have him work one of his miracles, but he just stood there and did not even answer me. That was really annoying. Who do he think he was? Didn't he know that I was the high priest? As the trial progressed, the witnesses were getting nowhere with their comments. In fact, they were contradicting each other. At that point, I needed to hasten the trial along because it would soon be daylight. The last witness quoted Jesus saying that in 3 days he would raise up the temple if it were destroyed. The argument was weak, since no one in their right mind would think that someone could do that. The thought then came to me that perhaps I could cause Jesus to condemn himself by admitting who he was. Then we could accuse him of blasphemy. I would make him declare under oath just who he claimed to be. Surely he couldn't be silent then. So I proceeded to say, "I adjure thee by the living God that thou tell us whether thou be the living God, the Christ, the Son of God." As I watched Jesus standing there, it seemed as if a flash of divinity crossed his face. As he answered, "Thou hast said." I will never forget his penetrating gaze. The remembrance still haunts me to this day. I felt as if I was standing before the judge of all earth, and it made me fearful to think of having to face all of my past deeds. Overwhelmed and frustrated by Jesus' words, I was furious and proceeded to tear my robes to show my displeasure. At that point, I called for his condemnation, accusing him of blasphemy, since he claimed to be God, and the council, in one accord, condemned him. Then I knew we were finally getting somewhere, Your Honor.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Pilate. Please state your name for the jury.
I am Pilate, the Roman governor under the Emperor Tiberius.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
I, Pilate, had heard of the man Jesus, but the first time we ever met was when he was brought to me as a prisoner of the Jews. I was called from my bedchamber in haste, and I wanted to make quick work of this situation of just another prisoner. The Sanhedrin had already condemned Jesus and wanted to have me confirm and execute the sentence of death. since they could not do so. I assumed my most severe expression for the occasion, but was surprised and awed to find a man of noble bearing and dignity standing before me, carrying no sign of guilt or fear or defiance in his expression. I had heard of Jesus' works and was curious to hear the charges that the Jews had against him. When I asked them what the charges were, they seemed annoyed, expecting me to respect their judgment. When I pressed them, they couldn't give me a reason. I had condemned other prisoners for little or nothing before, and I think the Jews were hoping that I would do the same. But there was something that caused me to hesitate. As I continued to press them for the charges, they brought in some witnesses, but their claims of this Jesus plotting against the Roman government seemed absurd. And I read in their charge their design to kill an innocent man. At one point, I asked Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" To which Jesus answered, "You say this." Caiaphas and those with him jumped on this admission by Jesus for me to witness that Jesus had admitted to the very crime of which he was accused. The crowd went wild with noise. So I drew Jesus aside and asked again, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Are you saying this of yourself, or did others tell you to ask this of me?" I knew what Jesus meant. He was inquiring as to whether I was really interested in receiving light from him. I will admit that I was convicted at that moment, but I was reluctant to admit it. As the crowd continued to clamor for a sentence against Jesus, I went out to them and declared, "I find no fault at all in him." The priests were furious at this and began to denounce me and threaten me with the censure of the Roman government. They accused me of refusing to condemn Jesus, who they stated had set himself up against Caesar. This accusation made me nervous, so I decided a solution might be to send Jesus to Herod, since he was from Herod's province. Herod sent Jesus right back to me because he did not find anything of which to condemn him. So that didn't work. I still had a problem. I decided that I might be able to appease the Jews by having Jesus scourged and then released. But the Jews didn't buy that, and instead they clamored for the death of Jesus. I was really in a tight spot. But I totally hesitated to condemn this obviously innocent man. Then I thought of how I might get out of this. We had a custom of releasing a prisoner of the people's choice on this occasion of the feast. So I offered them the criminal Barabbas, or Jesus, thinking that they would not choose to release the hardened criminal Barabbas. To my chagrin and disgust, the Jews were so anxious and worked up about Jesus that they chose to release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Christ?" I asked them. The surging multitude roared, "Let him be crucified." At this point, though I longed to deliver this innocent man from the worst possible death, I was afraid of losing my position because of the accusations that the Jews would bring against me if I didn't comply with their demands. With disgust and frustration, I commenced to wash my hands publicly in front of them to show that I wanted nothing to do with this situation. As you are all aware, Jesus was then horribly mistreated and led away to be crucified. And despite my efforts to save my position as governor, I soon lost it anyway. That is my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the next witness.
The court calls Judas. Please state your name for the jury.
I am Judas Iscariot.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
I was a disciple of Jesus. I early sought a position with his disciples, and I was urged by them to join the group. I was convinced that Jesus was a Messiah, and I hoped that I could secure a high position in his coming kingdom. As I observed Jesus and listened to his pure teaching, I was convinced that he read my heart, and the conviction came to me that my actions were selfish and evil. Jesus never rebuked me, but I had the feeling that he knew me well, but chose not to expose me to the other disciples. I think that he was hoping that I would change. Jesus entrusted me with the power to heal the sick, to cast out devils, and even to evangelize. But somehow I was not ready to fully surrender to him. After all, I felt that my judgment and opinions were valid and that I should be able to use them as I saw fit. I wasn't sure that the other disciples were as sharp as I was about finances, or that they could see opportunities or take advantage of circumstances like I could. I was made the treasurer for our group. While working for Jesus, I didn't see any great harm in treating myself to some of the funds on occasion. Something that bothered me was how often Jesus stated that his kingdom was not of this world. I was also upset that Jesus didn't avenge the death of John the Baptist. And why didn't Jesus respond to the Jewish leaders' demand for a sign? It would have been easy enough for him to do so after all. How was Jesus ever to take over and rule as king if he never asserted himself? All of these things preyed on my mind. I tried to get Jesus to allow himself to be made king after the feeding of the multitude, but he blew it and did not cooperate with what I saw as a great opportunity. If he would have just listened to me, all might have been quite different. After I realized that Jesus was offering only spiritual instead of worldly good, I saw that he could not offer me very much, so I decided to back off and just watch and see what would happen. When Jesus told the rich young ruler to sell everything in order to follow him, didn't he realize what an advantage such a man could offer with his wealth and prestige? Somehow, Jesus just didn't get it. That's why he needed me. When Mary anointed Jesus' feet at the feast in Simon's house, I was really turned off when I was rebuked for correcting Mary's extravagance in spending so much money just to pour on Jesus' feet. What a waste. That money should have been given to me, and I could have given some of it to the poor. At the Last Supper, I figured that if Jesus was to be crucified, then the fact that I had arranged it wouldn't change the result, and I would have more money in the purse. If Jesus was not to die, it would force him to deliver himself. So either way, I would come out on top. That way, Jesus would have to be careful in the future to show me due respect. I was promised 30 pieces of silver by the priests to betray Jesus. So what did I have to lose? After leading the mob to the garden where Jesus and the disciples were, I went up and kissed him to identify him, fully believing that he would escape from the mob. Instead, I watched and followed the mob and Jesus to the trial in Caiaphas' palace. After seeing the abuse that was heaped on him, I realized that Jesus was not going to escape. A terrible feeling of heavy and frightening guilt rent my soul until I could no longer stand it. I rushed to the throne of Caiaphas and screamed, "He is innocent! Spare him, O Caiaphas!" I threw down the bag of silver and grasped Caiaphas' robe, imploring him to release Jesus. In disdain and disgust, he shook me off angrily, realizing that the priest's plot in having me betray my master had been exposed. Being then spurned by the priests, I threw myself down at the feet of Jesus, acknowledging him to be the Son of God, and entreating him to deliver himself. When I saw that Jesus was not going to do so, in great despair, I rushed from the hall shouting, "It's too late! It's too late!" I could not bear the thought of Jesus being crucified, and I decided then and there to hang myself. That is my testimony.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Bailiff, you may call the last witness.
The court calls Marcus. Please state your name for the jury.
I am called Marcus.
Thank you. You may take the stand.
Tell us what you know of this man, Jesus.
Your Honor, I am a common thief. And I had the acquaintance with this man, Jesus, as did many of the people, by hearing his words spoken to the crowds that surrounded him each day. I was at first impressed with what he had to say, but after seeing him rejected by the priests and the rulers, I figured they must be right, so I discounted my first impression. Your Honor, I admit that I have not chosen my friends and acquaintances well, and I found myself getting into some serious trouble, so serious in fact that I ended up being convicted to die by crucifixion, just as this man Jesus was. I was there at the trial in the judgment hall, and I remember Pilate's declaration that they could find no fault in this man. I was with him as we were led out together to be crucified, and I could hear the comments of both ridicule and praise by those who followed us and accompanied us. I noticed Jesus' godlike bearing, and I noticed the pity and the forgiveness in his eyes for his tormentors. As I observed all of this going on, I once more became convicted that indeed this man was the Christ. I knew that I had no more to fear from man at this point, but strangely, I was convicted that there was a God to fear and a future to cause me to tremble. I realized that I would receive the due reward for my deeds. But I also realized that this Jesus had done nothing worthy of death. In this Jesus, I saw the promised Lamb of God that would take away the sins of the world. And I knew that I had sins that no crucifixion could pardon. A glimmer of hope crossed my mind. Could it be that even in this bleak hour, that this Jesus could help even me? Every fiber of my being clung to this hope, and with anguish, my soul cast itself upon this dying Savior, and I exclaimed, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." A bright light suddenly pierced the darkness and brought me peace and an acceptance with God as Jesus replied, "I say unto thee today, thou shalt be with me in heaven." No words can express the joy at his words as I realized that I, even I, a common and condemned criminal, could be saved. My happiness had no end. And even though I knew that I would shortly die, at last I knew that I could die in peace. And that is my testimony, Your Honor.
Thank you for your testimony. You may step down. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you have heard the testimony of each of these key witnesses who was acquainted with the man Jesus. After weighing these testimonies, if it is your judgment that this man is who he claims to be, that is, the Son of God, please stand indicating your decision.
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Our Father, as we have listened to the testimony of each of these witnesses, we are convicted of the truth of their words. As a result, we want to rededicate our lives to the high calling given to us in the person of Jesus Christ. We ask for your Holy Spirit's anointing that we may live as he lived. Please bless each of us to this end. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
The court is dismissed.